keep suffering, having self-pity and crying, just like a child. The child has a little aches and pains. He or she would be crying and crying until the mother or father, somebody, adults come and hold him and calm him down. So he cries. Similarly, some adults, just when they are suffering, they just suffer. They don't know anything. But the other option is to find a solution. When we are suffering, we think there must be then we must have a faith. In the past, I had this suffering, this pain, I have overcome that. Now I have this suffering, this sickness, I can overcome it. Just like this coronavirus. Coronavirus is affecting now more than 187 countries. More than 3 million people affected, and 1 million in the United States. And one-third of the world's corona patients are in the United States. Two-thirds of the world's death as a result of corona are in the United States. So it is so devastating, so pandemic. So instead of just keep suffering, we all have to think of ways of getting rid of this suffering. We do whatever we think would help us to get rid of this suffering. That is what is called faith. We have faith. When faith arises, this faith also has two sides. One is blind faith, and the other is positive, wholesome faith with understanding. That faith is called Avecha Prasad in Pali. Avecha means with knowledge, understanding. So the faith arises with understanding, is a wholesome faith. And so we have this faith. We understand the problem. We understand that it is very devastating. So instead of just keeping suffering, we must all try with the utmost faith in us, in our system, in our ability, in our wisdom, in our skill, education, using all of them. We have faith that something can happen, something that we can do. Like people who are trying various medicine, native medicine, Ayurvedic medicine, Western medicine, and injection pills and all kind of things, maybe including voodoos. We all are doing various things to get rid of this coronavirus. That is the faith. When we have faith, we have a faith. When we have faith, we enjoy it. We have gladness. Gladness. That means the proximate cause of gladness is the faith, endowed with understanding, positive, wholesome faith. How can we have gladness when we have faith? Because we are not just sitting just to suffer, but we apply our energy, our mindfulness, our wisdom, our understanding, our compassion, our metta, we use them. As we use them, we get more and more courage, more and more energy. We feel that we are not sitting in one place. We are helping others, talking to others, trying to help them. With all these things, we have a joy. Actually, only when we have faith, we make effort. That gives us additional courage, additional energy, additional power, and we will have a joy. This, of course, is true also in meditation, in other things. I'm trying to address the current, most current situation using the Buddha's teaching. Now, when we have joy, that joy becomes the approximate cause of rapture. The difference between joy and rapture is joy is very sort of active and is expecting something coming positive, seeing something from a distance, then something positive is happening. Rapture is the fulfillment when we have the real achievement, then we feel we are filled with rapture. So the rapture is gladness is the proximate cause for rapture. Then when there is rapture, tranquility arises, because rapture is so calming, soothing, comforting experience. Then tranquility arises. Tranquility is not artificially created, but gradually grows in our mind as we are doing something. This is very active state. Tranquility is, tranquility sounds like very passive, but it has a very powerful mental energy. That also calming, soothing energy. And that becomes the proximate cause for happiness. Happiness, when you have happiness, ordinarily when you have happiness, you will be excited, you will be you will express your excitement. You may laugh, you may cry even, you may kiss and hug and dance and all sort of things you would do if you have ordinary happiness. But when this kind of happiness arises, gradually, especially doing something very noble, that happiness becomes very soothing, comforting, experiencing inwardly without using word to express. It is a very powerful inward experience. Word becomes an impediment at that time. Word has no place at that time. Emotions has no place at that time, because it is so calming, soothing. When happiness arises, since it is calming, soothing, concentration arises. Now, with this, I want to stop right now, and I want to continue this after our meditation, and keep this in mind. This also would help us to do our meditation. We will see this happening just now as we are doing it. As I said, the Buddha's teaching is not something that brings result in future, but it is called the result immediately effective, experiencing here and now. And now we are going to experience it. Let us start our metta practice. Okay, now you can look at your screen and see the passages translated directly from Metta Sutta. May all beings be happy and secure. May all beings have happy minds, whatever living beings there may be, without exception, weak or strong, long, large, medium, short, subtle or gross, visible or invisible, living near or far, born or coming to birth, may all beings have happy minds. Let no one deceive another, nor despise anyone anywhere, neither from anger nor ill will, should anyone wish harm to another. As a mother would risk her own life to protect her only child, even so, towards all living beings, one should cultivate a boundless heart. One should cultivate for all the world a heart of boundless loving friendliness, above, below, and all around, unobstructed, without hate or resentment, whether standing, walking, sitting, lying down, or whenever awake. One should develop this mindfulness. This is called divinely dwelling here, not falling into erroneous views, but virtuous and endowed with vision, removing desires for sensual pleasures. One comes never again to birth in the womb.
These are very wonderful, meaningful things. Words, the ideas, wish, and this we do with the faith, confidence, and we really be happy to do this for all living beings. We are not doing it reluctantly, half-heartedly, but we do it with very sincere intention, and that makes ourselves very happy and pleasing. And then, with this thought in mind, let us begin our other step of practice, of other step of meditation. That is, breathe in, noticing inhaling exactly as it is. Breathe out, exhaling exactly as it is. Meaning without using words, concepts, ideas, or trying to control the breath. Let it flow in and out, and notice the beginning, middle, and end of each inhaling and exhaling. And these three sort of junctions take place very quickly. Only when we pay mindful attention can we notice them. At the beginning, we may not be that mindful. Our mindfulness may not be that sharp to notice all this. And therefore, just notice inhaling and exhaling and the pause between inhaling and exhaling. Then we slowly become aware of our feeling of inhaling, perceptions, attention, and consciousness. Similarly, we feel the feeling of exhaling, perceptions of exhaling, attention to exhaling, and consciousness of exhaling. And then when this happen, we can see inhaling, feelings, perceptions, attention, and consciousness also flow with the breath in and out. That means none of them stays the same, even for one fraction of a second. They move as the breath moves in and out. This is the nature of dependent origination. When one arises, the other arises. When one passes away, other passes away. So that also we have to keep in mind.
This is how we see dependent origination in action. So, since this is our topic, anyway, this we can see in our meditation practice. As they arise and pass away, we understand the impermanent nature of the breath, feeling, perception, attention, and consciousness. When we see this, there is nothing to excite, agitate. Our hindrances pass away, hindrances disappear, such as greed, resentment, and restlessness and worry, sleepiness and drowsiness, and doubt all slowly fade away. As they fade away, we gain the awareness of letting go, letting them go. We don't go after them to bring them back. We can let them go. That is the thought of letting go. And then arises our real deep awareness of metta, mind. This is what the Buddha called etang satin, this metta. This mindfulness arises this mindfulness of metta. And then arises compassion. When compassion arises, we have deep awareness of joy. This leads to happiness. That leads to concentration. As we mentioned earlier at the beginning of our little talk, when happiness arises, it leads to concentration. So the happiness is the proximate cause of concentration. When this happens, we also become fully aware of the deepest, subtlest changes which we otherwise do not notice. And these subtlest and deepest changes of the same thing like body, feeling, perception, attention, and consciousness. In this case, we may see all this in our breath. They are changing. They are very minute air particle moving in and out, and their change is not easily visible or discernible. Only when the mind is fully concentrated can we notice their changes. And noticing this, understanding this, we continue our practice.
Dukkha patta ca nidukkha, bhaya patta ca nibbhaya, soka patta ca nissoka, hontu sabbe pipanino. May the suffering be free from suffering. May the fear struck be free from fear. May the grieving be free from grief. So too may all beings be. Once again, friends, we very sincerely practice meditation. Our intention is to share our sympathy, our metta, loving friendliness with everyone that suffers, and those who have lost their loved ones, they suffer. Loved ones are gone, the living ones have pain, sorrow, lamentation, and despair. They need our metta, they need our compassion. We share our wisdom, compassion, and metta wisdom, wishing them to be peaceful and happy, relieve themselves from pain and suffering, and understand the true nature of life. Sooner or later, we all face that situation, live this life. This is what we see in the deepest way in our meditation. And we gain deeper insight, wisdom, that also helps us and them to overcome our sorrow and help them to overcome their sorrow. With this, let us continue our little talks on dependent origination. I mentioned that when happiness arises, concentration arises. So the proximate cause of concentration is happiness, where mind is free from hindrances. Mind is free from hurdles that blocks our development of our mind. When this happens, when gain concentration, this concentration becomes a proximate cause of seeing, of having the knowledge and vision. So the proximate cause of knowledge and vision is concentration. That is what is called yatha bhuta jnana dasana, very big Pali phrase. To see things exactly as they are. In our meditation, friends, if we followed the steps that I mentioned earlier, you probably might have seen things as they really are. You don't have to look in books, ask somebody, or do some research in lab. The lab is you. You are the laboratory where you will see things exactly as they are. And what are the things that you use in your lab to see things? Just like you take a piece of or drop of blood and put under a powerful microscope, and with clear eyesight, you look at or look into the blood, drop of blood through the powerful microscope. That would magnify the drop of blood for you to see what is there. Whether there is virus, that and germs, bacteria, mineral, and protein and so on and so forth, whatever is in the drop of blood, you can see with the powerful microscope when you look at it through it with very clear eyesight. Similarly, when you gain concentration with awareness, understanding, without any biases, prejudice, you will see what is happening to your body, in this case, the breath, feeling, perceptions, thought, and consciousness. These are the material you see to know what they really are. In there, you can see there is nothing static, nothing stays, nothing fixed. The present is the moving, changing activity. Activities are called sankharas. As I mentioned earlier, you can see bodily sankhara, oxygen exchanging with carbon dioxide, which you cannot see, but you can experience your feeling fresh and your tiredness moving, removing away, disappearing. And these are the gross signs of changes that take place within yourself, in your own body. That is seeing exactly as it is. The body is feeling, perception, thought, and consciousness are changing. And seeing this change, what we call impermanence, is the way that they are. And seeing them is seeing things as they really are. Here, things is the changing of the body feeling and so on, what we call aggregates. They are changing. They are impermanent. This impermanent nature you can see only when you gain true concentration without any emotion or without making yourself blind and trying without falling asleep, without being just a vegetable or vegetarian, vegetable. But you will see activities in the minutest, the sharpest, subtlest way. Activities in your body feeling and so forth, meaning they are changing. Action means changing dynamism. And this changing dynamism you will see in your own meditation practice. That is called seeing things exactly as they are. The approximate cause of this knowledge and vision. Knowledge is awareness of what is happening. Vision is seeing as it is happening. When you see things as they really are in this way, there arises a revulsion. Nibbida in Pali, Nibbida. So the proximate cause of Nibbida or revulsion is seeing things as they really are. Hitherto, before this, you have been deluded, confused, blind, and ignorant. Ignorance is the background of all this. But even in this situation, if you do not see this exactly as they are, you would be ignorant of them. When the ignorance disappears, there arises revulsion. Friends, revulsion is not anything negative,
but it is a very positive, mature, insightful understanding, realizing that they are empty. There is no anything for us to hold on to. This is called revulsion, nibbida. Nibbida in some languages translated into disappointment and depression and so on. Some people I know in at least in Sinhalese language, when they hear the word nibbida, they say in Sinhalese kalle kirenoa, meaning that they just, you know, don't feel doing anything. They are so depressed. This is not the depression or state of depression. Revulsion is awakening. Awakening from this slumber of ignorance. When we are awakened, we open your eyes and look around and see exactly what we have seen in us. We have seen in us things are changing, and that is exactly what is happening to anything that we have been appreciating, using, trying to hold on to. When revulsion arises, dispassion arises. So dispassion, the revulsion is the proximate cause of dispassion. Dispassion is, you know, people say, so he speaks passionately. He does things passionately. Not that kind of passion. But here, dispassion is you are blindly trying to hold on to something. That you hold on to something blindly without understanding. When you understand, you use that particular thing without passion. That is called dispassion. Dispassion doesn't mean that you are running away from your family and so forth, but you use the same thing with this deep awareness, understanding, maturity, insight, and wisdom. That is the real dispassion. When dispassion, then the proximate cause of the dispassion is the revulsion, and then arises liberation. Liberation, the proximate cause of liberation is called dispassion. That is the proximate cause. What is liberation? What do we liberate? We are not liberating from equal right and discrimination, this and that. No. We liberate from our own greed, hatred, and delusion. We liberate. This is not a political liberation, economic liberation, but this is the liberation from suffering, which is caused by ignorance. As we mentioned at the beginning, birth, the proximate cause of birth is becoming, and so forth. The proximate cause of suffering is birth. Now, this is how we learn to liberate from our suffering. Now, we are suffering these days, especially with this COVID-19, we are suffering. And we slowly and gradually learn to get rid of this with deep awareness, understanding, meditation, loving friendliness, and so on. And then follow this course of practice. And then we will be able to get rid of our suffering. So then what happened? liberation, when we liberate, and it becomes a proximate cause of knowledge of destruction. Knowledge of destruction. What do we destroy? Demolish. What do we destroy? We destroy the whole series of dependent origination. Ignorance, conditioning, conditioner, and consciousness, and so on. We have 12 steps of the dependent origination. Each of them leads to the following step, and until we learn to liberate ourselves from suffering. That is why the series ends saying, thus ends with the cessation of ignorance, whole mass of suffering comes to an end. And this is how it happens. Now, maybe I will soon speak on the karma and its relationship with the sankhara, or what is the sankhara and karma. These two we can discuss very slowly, taking one at a time, going step by step, because karma itself has a very complicated subject in many people's minds. Not the subject itself is complicated, but the people have made it, they complicated it by their wrong thinking, ignorance, not understanding. And therefore, I want to spend some time slowly and explaining how we should understand karma. According to the way the Buddha explained it, that is not my own, I have nothing to add, nothing to subtract what Buddha said. I simply repeat what the Buddha said in my language, my words. But the teaching, the message is the Buddha's message. With these friends, once again, I like to conclude this morning session. Wishing all those who are suffering, all those who are related to suffering beings, suffering persons, and all those who are helping them, and those who are helping must remain healthy. Those who are suffering must return to their normal, healthy life. And all others who are directly or indirectly, physically or spiritually, materially or otherwise, they help these people to recover. So they all are partners of this great work of helping each other, and they all are wonderful, wonderful, noble people. And I want to wish all of them be peaceful and happy, live long in very good health. With this, I want to conclude this, and I hope we see you tomorrow morning.